Hello and welcome to Prairie Pulse. Coming up a little bit later in the show, we'll see two stories from Prairie Public's Women Behind the Plow documentary. But first, joining me now is Jenny Olson, the Managing Director of the Office of Recovery Reinvented. Jenny, thanks for joining us today.
Thank you. It's my favorite conversation to have, so it's a pleasure.
Well, as we get started, tell the folks a little bit about yourself and your background, maybe where you're originally from.
I grew up in small town Cokato, Minnesota. Came up here for Concordia College in Moorhead, Minnesota. Started my Great Plains software internship, which led to an 18-year career at Microsoft. And now I'm here working on Recovery Reinvented, which is a crazy turn of events that has been an absolute amazing journey.
Well, now you just told me a minute ago that you've been in this program for a couple of years, but what is Recovery Reinvented?
Recovery Reinvented is a series of innovative, it's a platform to eliminate stigma and the shame and stigma of addiction across North Dakota. And basically, it's a series of innovative practices and initiatives that we implement year-round. And it's only been 2 years in existence, but it's really become a movement across North Dakota.
Yeah, so how is the program funded?
That's a beautiful thing. It is funded completely with philanthropic dollars. Donors, sponsors, every penny of what we have done with Recovery Reinvented has come from our communities because they see the need to eliminate shame and stigma of addiction. And we've had these fearless leaders in our governor and first lady of the state. Recovery Reinvented has existed for exactly 2 years now.
Okay. What about staffing?
I am officially the one and only employee of the Office of Recovery Reinvented. That said, Recovery Reinvented wouldn't exist if not for the army of volunteers and grassroots efforts that are happening across the state. First and foremost, our First Lady, who volunteers all of her time with Recovery Reinvented, and many, many others.
Yeah. Well, is there a physical location or office, or where does it work out of?
There is not an actual physical location. We work out of the governor's office at times, but really we are all across the state and spread out as needed wherever the spirit needs our work.
Yeah, so you mentioned the First Lady, and Katherine Helgaas Burgum sort of has taken this on, I believe. I can say that. But can you talk about her work on this a little bit more and the impact it's having around the state?
Absolutely. If it were not for the First Lady, Recovery Reinvented wouldn't exist. The birth of Recovery Reinvented came when Governor Burgum and First Lady Katherine took office. And the First Lady decided, after 15 years of being silent of her about her addiction to alcohol and her 15 years in recovery, that she was going to share her story so that more people could experience recovery and really tackle the shame and stigma that she had experienced. So when they took office, she very courageously shared her story, and the momentum just took off. And very clearly, it was recognized there's more to do, and we need to put some structure around this. So by executive order, the governor created the Office of Recovery Reinvented. So we are a part of the governor's office, but as I mentioned, completely philanthropically funded. So it's a really innovative solution to tackle this issue in our state really quickly.
Well, can you talk a little bit more about the First Lady, you know, going around talking to groups and meeting with people, I guess, who have survived or are struggling with this?
Absolutely. Much of what we do is traveling the state, and frankly, nationally as well, but traveling the state, meeting with groups, organizations, and individuals, and sharing the message of how we can together eliminate the shame and stigma of addiction. And the First Lady, a self-proclaimed introvert, I might add, very courageously tells her very detailed personal story of her struggle with addiction for many years and her journey into recovery. And the response from the people that we meet is so inspiring. People walk away with so much hope. They see the possibility in recovery and see what we need to do as a community. One of the most amazing things that she has done most recently when she goes around and visit with groups is she asks people to join her in terms of finding the courage to stand up and share our own stories of recovery. And she will, in a very large audience, national, local, whether it's Chamber of Commerce or a Nurses Association, whatever it might be, ask anyone in the room who is in recovery to stand up and be celebrated. And that is a moment that changes people's lives. It is so powerful every time that it happens. That those are examples of some of the ways that she's stepping out there and encouraging others in our communities and state to follow along, and it's making a big difference.
Well, can you tell us a little bit more about her story? I get we don't want to put words, in her mouth, but you've been around her and you know her story. And you told me, I guess, February was 18 years in recovery. But tell us a little bit more about her story.
Absolutely. As she will share, she struggled with addiction to alcohol and, was leading a very successful career. Very successful. The point being, addiction doesn't discriminate. And a lot of times, you don't know the stories that people are carrying around. She would be one of those examples with a successful career and a lot of friends, and tried many times to find recovery and start over. And after several relapses, finally found a program that worked for her and has stuck with it and worked very hard and is now channeling all of that experience to help others find the courage to seek help and find the hope that comes with recovery. And since she became First Lady, found that there may be a reason for all of this, and this is her chance to impact so many people.
And with that said, in the 2 years, I guess, that you've been with the program, what kind of results have you seen?
Well, number one, people keep coming up to us, at events or engagements and talking about how they just feel like the vibe is changing. The culture is changing. It is a conversation and a discussion that people are having. And that's what we've been asking for. Bring this conversation out of the shadows. Addiction is a disease and not a moral failing. And we need to start treating it as such. Whether it's the workplace, in schools, in our criminal justice system, from all angles. And we have been able, through a series of initiatives and programs, kick off some really innovative initiatives that have brought this to the forefront. Whether it was the Youth Ending Stigma Challenge that we launched, which worked with all the schools across North Dakota and offered up basically a grant to all of these different student groups. Pitch your idea for how you will eliminate stigma of addiction in your school or your community, and we will give you money to implement your program. And we had 17 schools participate across North Dakota. We've got an initiative in the workplace, recovery in the workplace right now. We did a $50,000 innovation competition, which was like Shark Tank for recovery. So many cool things happening that we hear from the public, these needs, these are public, and we get to respond quickly. And that's a really fun environment to work in.
Well, I understand that drugs are involved in about over half the arrests in North Dakota. Can you talk about some of those numbers?
That is true. Drugs and alcohol are involved in, I believe it's over 50% of the arrests in North Dakota. And 75% or more of the incarcerated population has some substance use disorder or mental health condition. And this is an opportunity to give huge kudos to the state of North Dakota. Their behavioral health division, the Department of Corrections, our legislators, understand that we need to treat this problem at the root cause and get these individuals the help that they need, because you can't incarcerate away this problem. And so in North Dakota, we have a very innovative free through recovery program, which helps those individuals who have been incarcerated get more access they wouldn't otherwise have to treatment and recovery resources for the substance use disorder or mental health conditions. And that has been proving very successful, reducing recidivism rates and creating a healthier population, returning to society productive citizens.
I assume finding help can be tricky in rural areas for this, but can you talk about the treatment options that there are around the state?
The fact that we are a state that is 50% rural definitely helps shape the conversation around addiction and recovery. And it's something that we talk about when we visit with other states around the country that is very unique to North Dakota. And one of the ways that we are trying to address the fact that we're a rural state is the Behavioral Health Division in the state right now is working on setting up the Medicaid process so that we can get more services that are community-based services and in-home services, because we're not going to have a treatment facility in every small community. And we're doubling down on a strategy called peer support specialist. That means somebody who has a lived experience with addiction and recovery can go through a training, become a certified peer support specialist. And these individuals are all over the state. We've already trained over 200, and the data has shown that it is a very successful and helpful model for helping an individual through their treatment and recovery journey. So getting things like these peer support specialists all over the state, in a rural state, is very key. And building things like recovery community organizations and all the different little communities across our state is also going to be another key point to address this in a rural state.
Mm-hmm. Do we know why addiction happens? I mean, is it something that triggers in the brain?
There is a ton of science that has been done, so much research on the brain, and we know a lot. A simple Google search will teach an individual so much, but very simply put, it affects, the drugs and alcohol affect the dopamine levels in the brain, and it essentially rewires the brain, essentially hijacks the brain's decision-making capacity, and it tells the brain that drugs and alcohol are the highest priority. And so things like food, housing, water, even taking care of one's own children can get sidelined by that hijacking of the brain. The beautiful thing is, though, that it can be treated, it can be managed, and that brain can get healthy again. And that is one of the things that one of the messages we try to share. There is so much hope and possibility for recovery, and we just need to get people the chance. One of the saddest things that I learned when I started in this job was that a majority of the people who are struggling with a substance use disorder, I believe it is only one in nine reach out for the help and the treatment that they need. That means there's a whole bunch of people struggling that likely aren't raising their hand asking for help because of the shame and stigma. That is what we're trying to change. So those individuals all get the help that they need because recovery is so possible.
Well, that's one of my questions here. That stigma surrounding people who've maybe admitted they failed or they don't have the willpower. So how do you get beyond that?
The stigma is very real, and we're seeing it as a barrier to so much, whether it's finding housing, finding employment, you're a business professional with a family to support. You're afraid that if I say I need help, I'm going to somehow lose my job. It's going to affect my income. Then I'm not going to be able to take care of my kids. My friends aren't going to want to hang out. The trickle-down effect is so dramatic. And it affects every facet of an individual's life in ways that I wouldn't have even realized until started living in this work and seeing it firsthand. And so that's one of the things we do when we travel around the state, challenge some of those misconceptions, and especially in things like the workplace. Sometimes unknown biases, and that is exactly what we're trying to tackle, and we're absolutely making progress on that dimension.
We don't have a lot of time left, but are there any initiatives you need to hit on real quick that are going on?
There's a ton, and we're trying to get employers to think about how do you create a culture of recovery in the workplace. We've got a stigma survey that we did in our state, first one in the country, how to measure stigma. Right now, North Dakota, it says 63% of individuals believe addiction is a disease, but that means there's still over 30% that believe addiction is a moral failing, and that is something that we need to change. So there's a lot out there, there's a lot going on, and individuals can find out even more about it with recoveryreinvented.com.
What should family or friends do if they suspect someone needs an intervention?
Number one, listen. Listen with open, caring, empathetic, without judgment, knowing there are many paths to recovery and then go find the professional resources. There is so many resources out there. Reach out to your local community groups, go online and learn about it. There's so much to learn.
Yeah. So if people want to get involved, can they?
Absolutely. RecoveryReinvented.com. There'll be opportunities to get involved. Our behavioral health division of nd.gov of the state, you can find a lot more information. There's volunteer opportunities, and there is so much work to be done in each individual community. I challenge people to figure it out what your community needs and let us know how we can help make that happen. But we want this happening everywhere.
All right. Well, Jenny, we wish you the best of luck with this, and thanks for joining us today.
Thank you, John.
Stay tuned for more. Being a woman in the male-dominated field of agriculture can be difficult. Here are two stories from Prairie Public's Women Behind the Plow documentary.
I always wanted animals, and so my dad told me I should marry a farmer. And I married a farmer, and we moved to Zealand in November of 1979, and we started out with 25 cows. I had to learn everything. I didn't know what I was doing, basically. How long to milk the cows, how to feed calves. I grew up in a home where there were three girls, so coming to a family where there was all boys, it was hard for them to adjust to a girl wanting to be outside and work. And so I think that was probably my biggest issue, was I felt like I had to prove myself all the time. I believe it's changed because I believe there are more women that are in agriculture now that have bit the bullet and just done it. I think that back when I was younger, it was a scary thing. And I think that when things happen to people's husbands, I don't know how many women actually stayed on the farm. I think now that men have adjusted to the fact that women can farm, I could totally see any one of my girls farming because of what they were taught. We have three daughters, Alicia, Kristen, and Emily. They worked hard. They all had to feed calves. I would say by the time they could walk, they probably held a bottle in their hand to feed calves. We always told them that we could have never farmed if they wouldn't have helped. After Tom passed away, we were very fortunate that the farm was paid for. There were people that thought I should sell out. They didn't know what I wanted here, but this is our home. We were on this farm for 34 and a half years together. I don't know where else I'd want to be right now. As far as men in the community, I have my handful of men who were totally awesome that came to help and still come to help. No questions. Pretty much let me make the decisions, but are always there to help if I need help. She is actually a crop adjuster, and she's always been my go-to person in the last 3.5 years. She comes home and helps me do things. After Tom passed away, she put the hay down for me and I baled it. So we're kind of a team, and her goal someday is to farm. This farm.
Growing up on my family farm was interesting. I would have not wanted to grow up any other way. I loved it. It taught me discipline. It taught me how to nurture baby animals. It taught me everything in my life, and I would have not wanted to grow up in any other way. I want to take over the farm. I'm definitely going to have another job to do this. Health insurance is a big deal. It boggles my mind how expensive it is for something that people need in life. So to have a job that will either A, pay for it, or B, help you pay for it, will make life 100 times easier. And with my crop adjusting job, it's pretty flexible. So I can still help in the field. I can still help plant if we're not busy. I can still fix fence, do all of those things, but yet I still have a job that I will be able to collect a paycheck and help with bills and all of that stuff. If a young man's coming back to farm, what's his wife supposed to do? because if he's coming home to a 500-acre farm, there's no way that they can both farm. She's going to need a job. And you usually have to drive 25, 30 miles for that job. It is very hard to be a woman in agriculture. It was an adjustment to be a woman in agronomy because dealing with old German farmers who are stern in a way and Roundup's gonna kill everything and I don't need all this other stuff, it's hard to explain to them that you can't spray Roundup all the time. It's gonna become resistant. We need to make a different plan. And for them to listen to a 21-year-old girl who's just came out of college is very hard. I wish that I would have more women to look up to in the agriculture world. So I'm hoping that I can be a big part of that. My best friends, I hope that they have little girls who want to farm or marry a farmer and at least be able to say, well, I got to drive a tractor today. That was my job. One person said to me one time that, I don't understand how you can farm. You put so much money into it and you don't get anything back. And I just laughed and I said, people don't farm to be rich. People farm because they love it.
Growing up on a farm, living an agrarian life, there were some strong women in my life. My Aunt Lydia lived next door. I don't think there was a piece of machinery she didn't like. She was good at everything in the house and out. Good with the animals. I was always so interested to see how much she seemed to enjoy farm life. My Auntie Lane, I don't believe she slept. She worked from morning till night, had five sons and a daughter, but she could milk those cows, come in, make breakfast, go back out, work in the yard, come in, make lunch, and then she would go back out. This was, it seemed, all summer long. She was amazing. My observation is that opportunities for women or young girls on the farm are there provided there's availability of land. In our family, we have the gift that my nephew is the third generation running that farm. So if his daughters or his son choose to farm, at least they likely would have a farm to do it. So let me tell you about my great niece, Carly. She lives on the farm I grew up on and loves her animals, loves her goat, loves horses, but loves her roosters and chickens. Has started a little cottage industry for those who want free-range eggs. And she and her dad built a couple of little different chicken coops. And I am so happy to see this full circle happen.
On our farm, we grow crops and cattle. I have roughly around 25 chickens, and we have two coops, and they just kind of do their own thing, come in throughout the day, lay their eggs. They are free range, so they get the whole farm to wander around, and we get about, I want to say, around 2 dozen eggs a day. At school, I sell the eggs to the teachers. They buy a lot of them, and then just community members, family, everybody just buys eggs from me, it seems like. My mom was in 4-H, my grandma was in 4-H, now I'm in 4-H. It's kind of a family thing. I absolutely love it. It's shaped me as the person I am today because of all the leadership skills I've learned. And nowadays, it is not just all agriculture. You can do sewing, cooking, you can do just about anything in 4-H. There's definitely some males in my class that think that farming isn't meant for a woman, so I have faced a lot of that because they claim that women aren't strong enough and women don't know enough about agriculture. Nowadays, anybody can become a farmer. And I especially have it good because my dad's a farmer and he is cool with me farming and everything. For three generations, it's only been males farming, so I'd kind of like to be the first female to become the fourth generation. It's really hard to become a farmer because you don't have a set salary. That's why it scares a lot of people away from agriculture, because if there's one bad storm, it could wipe out your whole farm and you could be broke. If a woman came up to me saying that they were interested in agriculture, I would definitely tell them that anything is possible. Because in this world today, women can do anything and they can do it just as well as a man.
Well, that's all we have on Prairie Pulse this week. And as always, thanks for watching.
Funding provided by the Tri-County Tourism Alliance, the Op Mertz family, the NDSU Library's German from Russia Heritage Collection, McIntosh County Bank, and by the members of Prairie Public.